this case, the sheriff's office who's going to be handling the surrender process, and then a number of other people who are part of it, of course, the defense attorneys as well. But for the former president, of course, Secret Service is going to be part of that process. In fact, our colleague Kelly O'Donnell has some new reporting that she spoke with her sources at the Secret Service, and they say that the Trump team has not yet communicated to them a time or a day when they plan to come down here and surrender. But notably, because of court schedules, already they're looking ahead to next week, not expected to happen at any point this week. But it is interesting, she says, according to her source, they've already been doing the walkthroughs. They've already been kind of looking at security, surveilling security down here in Atlanta to prepare for a potential surrender. Now, the other questions, though, of course, what will that look like? I've been told that nothing's off the table, theoretically, so we're talking about possible mugshots, possible fingerprints. Will it be at the jail? Will it be at the courthouse? All of those are things that are going to be ironed out in the coming days.
Well, and you take me to Vaughn. Vaughn, I know you're talking to your sources inside former President Trump's world. Do you have any sense of what that timeline might look like? Blaine saying it's not going to be this week, but do you have any sense of when we might see former President Trump go to the courthouse?
Kristen, I know those conversations were actually going on today. Former President Trump is at the hearing this week here. Right now, I think that we look at that all going on this week. What is that deadline?
Indictment. What were we learning at this hour?
This has been one of the most strange kind of episodes of this entire, breaking news situation, Kristen. So what we saw, just for those who aren't familiar yet, we saw another news outlet put up charges that were allegedly coming against the former president. Then basically we learned that there was a document that went up to where it was taken down. The clerk's office yesterday called it a fictitious document. The clerk put out another message giving a lot more clarity to what happened. Essentially saying that this was kind of a test one, and then once that error was discovered, it was immediately taken down. So this is kind of the first time that they're really admitting to the fact that this was in fact on their website. Before, it was kind of floated out there as some sort of fictitious document. We had questions. We were asking if that means somebody made it up to the leader of the fictitious document, or more likely was a mistake. It now appears that it was more likely a mistake on their part. It was taken down.
Cooperate. And based off of our reading of the indictment, it might be the case that Bonnie Willis already has some cooperation and are hoping for some more.
Ooh, fascinating. One of the other things that stands out about this that is that if you touch them, it mentions actions in the New Mexico as well. What's the significance of that? And Laura, does it run the risk of too long? Could there be too much in this indictment?
Well, it's interesting. So it's sort of a double-edged sword. Part of the way you charge this case is, again, using the Georgia racketeering statute, you're allowed to sort of bring in the color of what happened, the larger pattern, to show sort of the common scheme, even if she's not charging things that had happened in Arizona, she's allowed to bring that in. But at the same time, that just provides perfect fodder for the legal defense to say,
Oh!
Bonnie Willis signaling that she wants a fairly quick timeline, potentially to bring this case in the next 6 months. Is that realistic to expect to see that happen?
You can understand why, sort of in her first press conference, in the heat of the moment, after a very long day of everyone waiting to see what was going to happen, she might have had an aggressive posture last night saying, I'm going to take this case in 6 months with 19 defendants. That's not going to happen. That's just not possible. It's too many defendants. There's too many different complexities here. This is not a sort of an open and shut, easy case. It's complex, and it's complex for a reason. And she has a lot of different avenues and paths to potential conviction, but it's not going to be straightforward. And I think that that was sort of more of an aspirational hope as opposed to a realistic prediction of 6 months.
And Laura, just big picture, obviously, we go back to the fact that this is one of four indictments now. Does the judge factor in that there were three other indictments that were named before this one? Does that matter at all in terms of which indictment goes first?
So the judge isn't bound by the fact that this is now the fourth in terms of the sequence, but there is, again, the level of complexity here. And just the realistic aspect of the fact that at least the hush money case in New York has a trial date, the classified documents case has a trial date, although we'll see whether that one sticks too. And then soon we may find out, even next week, whether the case also about election interference, I know it's a lot to keep track of, but the federal case about election interference, that one's going to have a trial date set even next week. And so given that those might already be on the calendar, of course, I think the judge is, you know, going to take that into account. But there's nothing binding them to say just because she went last, that means the trial has to go last. I think the complexity is what's going to guide the court on this issue.
Well, we always appreciate your great legal analysis, and we want to say congratulations on being named Weekend Today co-host Peter Alexander. We are so excited. We can't wait to watch.
Thank you to you, as always, for all of your support, Kristen, as always. Thank you.
Always. Well, you're tremendous, and we're excited about it.
Thank you.
See you soon, Laura. Thanks. Coming up, we're sticking with the story and breaking down why Trump's fourth criminal indictment could be the most complex case yet heading into 2024. Our team of legal experts dives in next. Plus 91 criminal charges, four indictments, one frontrunner, and just 8 days until the first Republican presidential debate. How Mr. Trump's relentless legal drama is playing out on the campaign trail. That's ahead. You're watching Meet the Press now.
Thank you. We've got breaking news. Sometimes there are no words.
The flashbangs are continuing to go off.
What emotions go through you as you're watching these girls?
These are really important moments in our history, and people remember who shared that news with them.
Welcome back. The RICO Act was designed back in the 70s to prosecute organized crime, and it's arguably best known for its use in mob cases. But that's how the DA in Fulton County has charged all 19 defendants with violations of Georgia's RICO Act. The indictment lays out 161 acts that alleges were part of the racketeering conspiracy, including emails, phone calls, and tweets by former President Trump, his allies, that they carried out across multiple states. Joining me now to help us better understand the legal complexities, criminal defense attorney Danny Stavalos, former federal prosecutor and Superior Court Judge Carol Lamb, both are NBC News legal analysts. And with me from Georgia is former Georgia Attorney General Sam Olens. Thanks so much to all of you for being here. Really appreciate it. Carol, let me start with you. We've been talking about the fact that this is just a massive case. It's sweeping 19 defendants, 41 counts. How do you begin to prosecute a case this big, this sweeping?
Well, when you have that many defendants, there are some good things about it, there's some bad things about it. The good thing about it for DA Fannie Willis is that it really does tell the whole story. Everybody who is culpable in all of this grand scheme in Georgia is a defendant in this case. Where it's not so much of an advantage is that it makes everything very unwieldy. It becomes a very unwieldy potential trial. Even pretrial is very unwieldy because you have a lot of pretrial motions that Danny can undoubtedly tell you about. It's like a large animal moving underwater. It's even hard to schedule a hearing because you have so many defendants and so many attorneys in the case, but it does permit her to tell the whole story. I think one of the interesting things about this is we haven't seen a lot of evidence of people pleading guilty and cooperating here. Undoubtedly, there are cooperators. There are a lot of people referred to in the indictment as individual one, individual 19. So obviously there are people cooperating, but we haven't seen a lot of guilty pleas being taken, and that may happen during the course of the pretrial proceedings.
Sam, let me get your take on that, because as we were just discussing in the previous segment, there has been some crossover between this indictment and the indictment brought by Jack Smith, the indictments, I should say. Do you expect some of the co-defendants to flip?
Well, one of the very interesting things is that Mark Meadows is a defendant in this case. He didn't really appear in Jack Smith's indictment. He didn't appear as a defendant, and he doesn't appear to be described as a co-conspirator in the indictment as six others were. And I think the prevailing thought in the legal community was, well, he must be cooperating. But to have him appear in Fannie Willis's indictment as a defendant really puts a big question mark on that, because you have to wonder, if he's cooperating in Jack Smith's case, why is he being indicted in Fannie Willis's case? I think that's problematic. I hope it doesn't indicate a lack of coordination between the two prosecutions. But yes, there's a question mark with respect to Mark Meadows, and with respect to the others, I think, given the fact that we're looking at potentially...
Danny, if you were the former president,
issues to show what was occurring in the big picture rather than the small picture, permits violations that technically related to other defendants than the former president. So by doing this over and over again, he's permitting the jury to literally understand why it's a criminal enterprise or why it is considered a criminal enterprise. And that's very beneficial to the prosecutor.
Carol, let me go back to you. Do you think that there will be additional superseding indictments? What are you expecting in that regard? And let me ask you about something that we've been talking about throughout the show, which is there a risk in this being so sweeping?
Well, I actually don't expect a superseding indictment in this case unless there's a defendant or more defendants to be added. It looks like the charges themselves are pretty comprehensive. So in the interest of keeping this case moving as quickly as I can, but I don't think it's going to be a quick case to get to trial. But in that interest, I wouldn't expect a superseding indictment. I want to be clear about one thing. Count one is a conspiracy / racketeering conspiracy charge. And the difference between